In the second and third sections, we introduce metrics and their gradients. Now we move to the fourth section, where we will incorporate the gradient into the gradient ascent algorithm to find optimal policies. Let's take a look at it. The basic idea of the gradient ascent algorithm is this. Theta t plus 1 equals theta t plus alpha times the gradient of j theta, where theta is the parameter and alpha is the learning rate or step size. The gradient of the objective function, which we have already calculated, is here. However, this is not usable in practice. Why? Because there is an expectation here that involves the state distribution. But we don't know this distribution. Therefore, we cannot compute this expectation directly. To solve this problem, we can use a stochastic gradient to replace the true gradient. It gives us this new equation. Nevertheless, this equation is still not directly usable. Why? Because there is a qpi term here, which is the true action value corresponding to the policy pi. To solve this problem, we can replace qpi with an estimate qt. How to calculate the estimated action value qt? We have studied two methods so far in this course, if you still remember. The first method is the Monte Carlo method, which is the most straightforward one. Specifically, to estimate qpi sa, we start from sa, generate an episode, and compute the return, say g. This g can be used as an estimate of qpi sa. Combining this Monte Carlo method with the policy gradient algorithm, we can get an algorithm called reinforce. I will explain this algorithm in more detail shortly. In addition to this Monte Carlo method, there is another method for estimating action values, the TD method. If we combine the TD method with the policy gradient algorithm, then we can get a series of algorithms called actor-critic. We will cover actor-critic algorithms in the next lecture. So, we've completed the introduction to the policy gradient algorithm, and the basic idea is actually quite simple. Now let's clarify three important points. The first point is about how to perform sampling. We've mentioned that this is the true gradient and we need to use a stochastic gradient to replace the true gradient. The random variables involved here are S and A. So how do we sample SA? First, how to sample S? For S, its distribution follows either D or eta. What is this distribution? It represents the long-term distribution of S after running for a while. It would be ideal in theory to sample S after we run the policy for a while. However, we usually don't do this in practice. Since samples are precious, we use them without considering the distribution strictly. Second, how to sample A? A should follow the policy pi. Therefore, for a given state S, I should sample action A based on the current policy pi. This is why the policy gradient algorithm is on policy. In particular, since the policy is continuously improving, it is the target policy. Since the action should be generated by the policy as well, it is also the behavior policy. Hence, the policy gradient algorithms are on policy. We can convert on policy algorithms to off policy, but it requires additional techniques which we will discuss in the next lecture. Now, let's move on to the second important point. That is about how to interpret this algorithm. Some of you might think, isn't this just a simple gradient ascent algorithm? Isn't it just optimizing the objective function? That's true, but let's reorganize the expression of this algorithm. You will see that there are many interesting properties. This part is already familiar to us. The gradient of ln pi is equal to the gradient of pi divided by pi. The algorithm we previously presented looks like this. I replace the gradient of ln pi with the expression on the right, move the denominator here, and put qt in the numerator. Then, I put the numerator here and denote this term as beta t. Then, the equation becomes theta t plus 1 equals theta t plus alpha beta t times the gradient of pi. Here, alpha and beta t together form the new step size. This equation is quite interesting. What is it doing? It is actually optimizing pi a t s t. To explain, suppose we would like to optimize an objective function f theta. The corresponding gradient algorithm would look like this. Theta t plus 1 equals theta t plus step size times gradient of f theta. Similarly, It is not difficult to see that this algorithm is optimizing pi ATST by updating theta. This is quite intuitive. When the step size is sufficiently small, we can illustrate what this algorithm does much clearer. Why do we emphasize that the step size should be sufficiently small? Let's see an example. If there's an extremum and I start from here, following the gradient will move me toward the extremum. But if the step size is too large, I might overshoot and end up on the other side. Only within a small range can I be sure that following the gradient will lead to the extremum. So, we assume that both alpha and beta t are small. With this assumption, it's easy to understand what this algorithm is doing. Specifically, we have the following conclusions. First, if beta is greater than 0, then pi ATST theta t plus 1 is greater than pi ATST theta t. That is, the new theta obtained from the algorithm will increase the value of pi ATST. The larger the step size, the larger the increase in pi. Of course, the step size cannot be too large as we assumed. Second, if beta is less than 0, this corresponds to gradient descent. In this case, the new theta obtained from the algorithm will decrease the value of pi ATST, making it smaller than pi ATST, theta t. Why do we have the above two conclusions? Why does the value become smaller when beta is less than 0? In fact, we can explain using a mathematical explanation, and it's quite simple. First, let's look at the expression of pi ATST theta t plus 1. Pi ATST theta t plus 1 equals pi ATST. Theta t plus the gradient of this term transpose and then times theta t plus 1 minus theta t. Here, the gradient is a vector, and we multiply it by theta t plus 1 minus theta t, which is also a vector. Why does this expression hold? This is actually based on the definition of differentiation. When theta t plus 1 minus theta t tends to 0, this approximation turns into an equality. In other words, the approximation becomes exact as theta t plus 1 and theta t get closer. Of course, as theta t plus 1 and theta t become farther apart, this approximation becomes less accurate. But as long as theta t plus 1 and theta t are not too far apart, this holds. Now, let's substitute in a specific theta t plus 1 and see what we get. We replace the blue part with the gradient, and the previous expression becomes alpha beta t times the gradient of this transpose times this gradient, which is the squared norm of the gradient. Now it is very clear. The squared norm of the gradient is always greater than or equal to 0. Therefore, when beta t is greater than 0, we know that theta t plus 1 will be greater than theta t. On the other hand, when beta t is less than 0, theta t plus 1 will be smaller than theta t. So, this is the mathematical explanation of the two conclusions we mentioned earlier. Now let's examine the two conclusions more closely. When beta t is positive, the value increases. When beta t is negative, the value decreases. Why is this important? Because it helps us understand the role of beta t in the algorithm. In a word, beta t is crucial for balancing exploitation and exploration. Why? It is quite interesting. Let's take a look. First, the numerator of beta t is qt, and beta t is proportional to qt. When qt is large, beta t also becomes large. What does a large beta t mean? It means that pi ATST probability of choosing action AT in state ST will increase. In other words, if an action's value is large, I will increase the probability of choosing this action. This is the essence of exploitation. That is, if I already know that this action will give me a larger action value, then I will give it a higher probability of being selected. This is exploitation. Now let's look at beta t again. Its denominator is pi, so beta t is inversely proportional to pi. If qt is positive, then when pi is small, beta t will be large. That is, a smaller pi ATST results in a larger beta t. Then, a larger beta t leads to a larger pi ATST at the next time step. What does this mean? It means that if the probability of selecting action AT is low, then I will increase the probability of selecting this action in the next step. This is exploration. Thus, beta t balances exploration and exploitation through the terms in the numerator and denominator. It ensures that both exploration and exploitation are well balanced. Just now, we introduce some properties of this algorithm which are quite interesting. Now let's take a look at a specific algorithm. This is the algorithm we just discussed. Here, Qt is used to approximate QPy. We have already studied that there are methods to estimate values, Monte Carlo and temporal difference methods. If we use the Monte Carlo method, Qt is obtained from an episode starting from STAT, and the return of this episode GT is assigned to Qt. This is the Monte Carlo method. If this is the case, then the policy gradient algorithm is called reinforce. Reinforce is the simplest and earliest policy gradient algorithm. More algorithms, similar to this one, will be introduced later, especially when we introduce the actor-critic methods in the next lecture. Let's take a look at the pseudocode of the reinforce algorithm. In the kth iteration, what do? First, we select an initial state, and the parameter of the current policy is theta t. So the current policy is pi theta t. Then we interact with the environment using this policy to generate this episode. For each element in the episode, we do the following two steps. The first step is value update. For example, if we arrive at state action pair STAT, we need to estimate QT. How do we estimate QT? We use the Monte Carlo method. Starting from STAT, we sum all the rewards received after that, which gives us QT. Once we have QT, we can substitute it into the algorithm and update theta t to get a new theta t plus 1. After completing the episode, we can take the final theta t as the new theta k and use it to generate the next episode. This forms a loop. Some of you might have noticed something interesting here. Why doesn't theta t plus 1 immediately generate new data after it is updated from theta t? This is because the method is based on the Monte Carlo method, which is offline. This means that you must collect all the episodes first before you can start training. Therefore, it does not update theta t and generate new data at the same time. However, when we incorporate temporal difference methods into policy gradient methods as shown later, it will become an online method. In that case, once we get a new theta t, we can immediately use it to generate new data. So far, we have covered the main content of this lecture. Now let me provide a brief summary. In this lecture, we introduced policy gradient methods. The core idea is actually quite straightforward. That is, we define an objective function, compute its gradient, and then optimize this objective function using a gradient descent algorithm. While the idea is simple, every step, including the objective function, the gradient derivation, and the algorithm derivation, may be non-trivial to learn. Nevertheless, I hope you can firmly grasp the idea that this is essentially an optimization problem. Once this idea is clear, you are less likely to feel lost as you work through the details. In today's lecture, we introduced reinforce, which is the first policy gradient algorithm in our course. In the next lecture, we will delve into the actor-critic method. That's all for today. See you next time.